This training module on coke plant defines the processes and highlights the key performance parameters adopted at Tata Steel for the production of coke. Tata Steel's coke oven department produces 2.3 million ton of coke per annum for the production of hot metal. The role of a coke plant in an integrated steel plant is to produce coke from coal and supply it to the blast furnaces, supply coke oven gas as fuel. Coal is obtained from various resources, blended in the correct proportions before being crushed to the right size in preparation for coke making. The crushed coal is stamped into a cake before being subjected to heating in ovens in the absence of air to carbonize into coke. The coke is screened and the correct size used for iron making. Tata Steel was the first steel producer in India to adopt the stamp charging technology. Stamp charging being most suited for indigenously available, inferior quality and cheaper coals has enabled Tata Steel to become the lowest cost producer of hot metal in the world. Battery numbers 3, 5, 6 and 7 comprise an independent coal handling, cum blending and a coal crushing unit to supply crushed coal to 198 ovens. Battery number 3 has 54 ovens and uses the conventional top charging process. A charging car, pusher car, guide car, dog car and a quenching car are integral parts of this battery. Battery numbers 5, 6 and 7 contain 30, 60 and 54 ovens respectively using the latest stamp charging technology. Battery numbers 8 and 9 comprise an independent coal handling, cum blending and a coal crushing unit to supply coal to 140 ovens using stamp charging technology. Battery numbers 8 and 9 have a separate coke screening facility. All the batteries have a common byproduct plant to remove impurities from the coke oven gas and supply it as fuel to the integrated steel plant. Coal suitable for coke making is chosen on the basis of its rank, according to its maturity and relative carbon content, physical properties including moisture, volatile content, size and hardness, chemical properties on the basis of ash content, fixed oxygen, hydrogen, sulfur, phosphorus and presence of alkalis. Rheology, or the study of the fluidity and plasticity of coal when it undergoes thermal treatment in the batteries. Petrographical property helps in classifying the coal on the basis of reactives such as vetronite primarily and inerts such as inertinites and mineral matters that reinforce and offer strength to the coke. Coal in India has high ash content. Therefore, washing and blending of coal are required to reduce the ash content and conserve metallurgical coal. The relative proportion of inerts and reactives, the rank of the reactives, and coal having identical temperature range of fluidity are important parameters for blend selection. Based on their coking property, coal is graded as prime or HCC, medium or semi-hard, and blendable or semi-solid. The criteria for selecting coal for blending are techno-commercial, including cost of coal blend, availability of coal, consistency in supply, quality of coke required, transportation cost. Coking coal is heated in the coke ovens in the absence of air, wherein certain changes take place. Moisture evaporates between 100 degrees centigrade to 150 degrees centigrade. Volatile matters get released between 300 degrees centigrade to 600 degrees centigrade. Plastic zone is formed and coal swells at about 450 degrees centigrade. Coal solidifies to semi-coke as temperature rises from 450 degrees centigrade to 650 degrees centigrade. Hydrocarbons get released at about 800 degrees centigrade. Only hydrogen is released above 800 degrees centigrade. On further heating, the carbonization cycle is finished at about 1250 degrees centigrade, wherein coal hardens and shrinks to become coke. Let us take a look at the role of coke in the blast furnace to appreciate its requirements better. The blast furnace charge consists of five zones, including granular zone, cohesive zone, active coke zone, raceway or combustion zone, and hearth zone. Granular zone. The size spectrum of the coke charged into the furnace should be narrow. The coal strength of coke, termed as M40, should be high to avoid generation and segregation of the smaller sized coke, causing improper distribution across the cross section of the blast furnace. The coal strength and proper sizing during screening are essential. Cohesive zone. The geometry of the cohesive zone should ideally be thin, steep, and uniform around the furnace axis. Good Bosch permeability and raceway penetration ensures a desirable geometry of the cohesive zone. Coke with low reactivity and coke strength after reaction, referred as CSR, is desirable. Active coke zone. Molten iron and slag trickle through the intricacies in this active coke zone, where the coke forms into a loosely packed bed, counter to the ascending gases. At times, the melt is compressed between the coke and the gases, and even forced up due to built-up gas pressure, affecting proper furnace operations. The coke must possess sufficient after-reaction strength, large mean size, and optimum reactivity. Raceway zone. The volume of wind and the quality of coke in front of the tuyeres ensures a good blast penetration, improving central gas flow. The after reaction strength of coke is a very important parameter for good raceway operation, since the wind volume is indirectly dictated by the Bosch coke permeability. Hearth zone. Poor quality coke reduces the depth of the raceway, causing the dead man to increase in size and descend to the hearth, affecting hearth permeability, causing peripheral drainage problems. Besides, the ash content of the coke determines the quantum and viscosity of slag generated. Hence, the properties of coke that ensure a stable furnace operation are the mean size of coke charged, the optimum value of M10 and M40 of coke, the CSR value or the coke strength after reaction, the moisture content in coke, the carbon content in coke that provides the primary fuel, coke reactivity index or CRI, the percentage of ash in coke. High quality blast furnace coke results in lower coke rate, higher coal injection, higher productivity, and lower hot metal cost. To achieve the desired parameters, it is important to ensure correct blending of different grades and rank of coal, proper sizing of coal particles during crushing, correct moisture content of coal, high bulk density of coal, controlled rate of heating during carbonization, proper quenching of coke, sizing and screening of coke for use in blast furnace, stable operating parameters. Tata Steel receives prime, blendable and semi-soft grades of coal from Jharia, Bhilatand, West Bokaro and Australia and New Zealand. Coal is brought in wagons and unloaded into silos with the help of wagon tipplers. A conveyor system carries the coal to the blending bins. Extreme care is taken to ensure that the correct grade of coal is stored in its designated blending bin. Each bin is equipped with ultrasonic level sensors to monitor stock levels. Every bin is provided with an individual weigh feeder comprising a short conveyor with load cells. The quantity of coal discharged can be controlled by varying the belt speed. Flap limit switches sense the stoppage of material flow and actuate vibrator motors to restore the coal flow. Two methods are used for selecting the blend. Automatic blend selection is on the basis of the percentage of the coal as per the required blend. Manual blend selection is on the basis of the coal weight as per the required blend. Currently, the blend regime followed is HCC or hard coking coal 5%, West Bokaro 48%, Jamadoba 6%, New Zealand 7%, SS or semi-soft 29%, spillage or recycled 5%. The blended coal is conveyed via a unidirectional conveyor belt equipped with a belt magnet to separate the small magnetic materials. A metal detector is installed to detect any metallic material and accordingly trips the respective group of conveyors. Coal, free of metal, is unloaded to a reversible conveyor which feeds the coal to two primary crushers, PCR1 and PCR2. The output of primary crushing is -3.15 mm within 88 to 90% efficiency and -0.5 mm within 48 to 50% efficiency. Crushed coal is conveyed through a conveyor equipped with a belt weigher, neutron moisture gauge and water addition system. The moisture helps to improve the bulk density of coal and coal cake stability. The crushed and moist coal is transferred to the secondary crushers SCR1 and SCR2. Coal is conveyed through a series of conveyor belts to coal tar bins that supply crushed coal to its coke ovens. Stamp charging is done to produce high quality coke from inferior coal blends by increasing the bulk density of coal and in consequence increasing the oven throughput. The mammoth 700 ton SCP machine moves on 16 wheels with 8 drives on a track longitudinally with a precise positioning arrangement. The SCP machine is filled with prepared coal through 4 outlet gates of the service bunker with the help of coal hoppers. The SCP machine thereafter travels in front of the pre-selected oven chamber ready to be pushed. Simultaneously, the coal is fed from the hopper onto a charging plate housed in the stamping box. Drop hammers start to stamp the coal into a cake. The strength of the coal cake depends on the specific stamping energy, which in turn depends on the weight of drop hammer, number of drop hammers, height of drop, frequency of drops per minute, and stamping time. Stamping takes place in layers, increasing the bulk density while compacting the coal into a 24.2-ton dry cake ready to be charged. The SCP machine uses infrared rays to get into position to push a pre-selected oven. Simultaneously, the coke transfer car, or CTC, and the quenching car get aligned automatically at the coke end with the help of interlocks and radio communication with the SCP. The CTC opens the oven door and is ready to receive the coke. The SCP door manipulator slews in by 90 degrees and advances to the oven door. The manipulator unlocks and lifts the door and finally retracts while slewing out with the door by 90 degrees. The pusher ram travels forward at normal speed and slows down as it touches the coke and again picks up normal speed to push the coke out of the oven. The frame cleaner slews in by 90 degrees and advances to press against the frame and cleans it. The frame cleaner slews out by 90 degrees and retracts. The SCP moves and repositions itself to charge the oven recently emptied. Simultaneously, the charging gas transfer car on the roof of the oven readies itself to transfer large volumes of gases emitted during charging. The U-tube of this car connects the mini stand of the oven being charged to the mini stand of the oven into which gas is being transferred. At the same time, the CTC repositions itself and closes the door at the coke end. The charging plate with the coal cake moves into the oven backed by a moving trestle. The trestle gets locked in position as the charging plate is withdrawn. The SCP repositions itself to close the oven door. The SCP door manipulator slews in with the door by 90 degrees and drops the door in position before locking it. The manipulator retracts while slewing out by 90 degrees. The pushing schedule follows a 5-2 cycle. In the sense, a battery with 54 ovens, where oven numbers 1, 6, 11 up to 51 will be pushed, followed by oven numbers 3, 8, 13 up to 53, followed by oven numbers 5, 10, 15 up to 50, and so on till the 54th oven is pushed. This minimizes the thermal shock on the heating chambers during pushing and charging, offering longer refractory life. The coal cake is put in an oven 13.75 meter long, 4.57 meter high, and 0.45 meter wide at the ram end and 0.47 meter wide at the coke end respectively. The oven is slightly wider at the coke end to facilitate easy pushing. The size of the coal cake is smaller than the oven size, ensuring a gap between the oven walls and roof. The heating cycle is approximately 20 hours. The coal adjacent to the hot oven walls softens and becomes plastic at 450 degrees centigrade. The heat front advances progressively to the next layer. Simultaneously, the layers closer to the hot surface change from semi-coke to coke. This sequence continues layer by layer from both ends until the plastic layer reaches the center of the oven. The semi-coke to coke phase takes place between 475 to 600 degrees centigrade while developing fissures and shrinking. The gases escape from the hotter end through the fissures developed in the semi-coke and coke layers. The volatile matter entrapped in the plastic layer exerts pressure, which gets transmitted to the oven walls. The amount of pressure developed depends on the permeability of the plastic layer and the rate of gas evolution. The dilatation behavior of the coal mass, being critical to the quality of coke, depends on the bulk density, type of coal, particle size, and heating rate. Bulk density. Compacting the coal charge improves the oven throughput and coke strength. However, tighter packing between the intergranular space between the coal particles and the plastic mass formed during carbonization offers greater resistance to the gas flow, resulting in an expansion of coke mass. Type of coal. The quantum of volatile matter is controlled by proper blending. Thereby, the dilatation behavior of the coal mass is indirectly governed by the quantum of volatile matter in it and the maturity of coal. Particle size. The coal particles, being small, have a greater surface area to volume ratio, fuse better with its neighboring particle, and produce a more homogeneous mixed phase. This ensures higher coke strength after reaction, or CSR. Besides, smaller particles also decrease the plastic range temperature and maximum fluidity during carbonization. Heating rate. Controlled heating allows control over the viscosity and the plastic layer thickness. Besides, it controls the generation of the volatile matter, in turn controlling swelling and coking pressure. Structure and heating system. The auto design is a two-stage twin flue regenerative under jet coke oven, which can operate either under rich coke oven gas or lean blast furnace gas or a combination of both. The benefits of twin flue heating walls are fast carbonization, better strength and capacity of coke in spite of high throughputs, accommodate large volume of combustion gases at low differential pressures over the length of the heating wall, maintain a uniform temperature gradient across the entire height of the heating wall. The important constructional parts of a battery are concrete structure, refractory material, battery anchorage system, regenerators, heating walls, oven top. The concrete structure consists of a strongly reinforced substructure, which is made up of a base or a foundation slab. Rigid interconnecting columns rising from the foundation slab support the nozzle deck. Concrete pinion walls at each end of the battery are firmly tied to the base slab. The refractory structure is divided into four stages: sole flues, regenerators, heating walls, oven decking, that is, oven top brickworks. Regenerators are provided in a battery to preheat the inlet air and gas. The regenerators in the auto design are continuous between ram side and coke side and are connected to the heating flues by short ducts. There are two regenerator compartments under each oven, and these are connected alternatively left and right to alternate flues on each side wall of the oven. The other alternate flue of a hairpin is connected to the pair of regenerators below the adjacent oven chamber. Four sole flues form a composite part of the regenerator. Oven chamber being tapered, there is an increase in volume from the ram to the coke end. Hence, the heat requirement from the ram to the coke end gradually increases. For this purpose, the nozzle plates of the regenerator cells are independently adjusted to increase the air and gas flow through the nozzle plates. Hence, uniform and controlled air and gas flow is obtained with optimum heat recovery in the regenerator. The heating walls of the oven consist of 14 pairs of twin flues connected at the oven top through a hairpin bend. The twin flue system enables accurate distribution of air and gas, ensuring an even temperature distribution within the coke mass. The heating unit of a battery consists of the air regenerator cell, the lean gas regenerator cell, waste gas regenerator cell, one pair of heating flue, and a straight CO gas riser pipe. 14 heating units side by side represent a heating wall. Combustion of the fuel gas takes place in one flue, and the products of combustion pass over the hairpin bend into the adjacent flue, into the waste gas regenerator. A 20-minute heat reversal cycle for firing the alternate twin flues is maintained using a hydraulic reversal system. Regenerators are heat exchangers made up of refractory bricks and are operated in pairs. The chambers are operated in a cycle of alternate heating and cooling. The hot flue gases flowing downwards release heat into the chambers. Air or gases pick up this heat while passing through the chamber and proceeding into a flue for combustion. Lean gas firing includes BF gas enriched with LD gas and CO gas to maintain the calorific value of 900 kilocalories per normal meter cube. During lean gas firing, only one regenerator compartment is required to preheat the air, while the other is used to preheat the lean gas. The waste gases pass through the waste gas regenerator, where the checkered bricks retain the heat from the waste gas. During the reverse cycle, the air and lean gas pick up heat from these checkered bricks. During CO gas or rich gas under firing, two adjacent regenerators are used to preheat the combustion air, while the other two adjacent regenerators under the next oven receive the hot combustion products to heat up the checker bricks. A preheater is used to heat the rich gas. Coke oven gas is distributed in the battery basement under the nozzle deck by means of under-fire headers from the distribution main and rises through individual vertical riser pipes to the different burners in the heating flues. The under-firing headers are supplied from a single distribution main, and a progressive adjustment can be obtained across the length of the heating wall by adjusting the calibrated metal nozzles. The advantages of the twin flue heating system are uniform vertical heat distribution in the oven because of the air stage combustion, uniform horizontal heat distribution from the pusher to coke end because individual heating units in each flue can be adjusted. The heating rate across the oven chamber can be controlled for proper carbonization. During the pushing process, the ram travel is interlocked with the movement of the quenching car, ensuring that the hot coke is dumped evenly along the length of the quenching car. This avoids piling of hot coke and ensuring proper quenching. The quenching car takes the hot coke to the quenching station. Optical pyrometers take temperature samples of the coke before its entry into the quenching station. The average temperature recorded is compared with the set coke temperature for analyzing the quality of carbonizing. At first, water is sprayed through the nozzles from the sides of the quenching station and then from the top. This enables proper quenching with least moisture retention in the coke. The coke is carried to the wharf for dumping after quenching. The wharf inclination coincides with the inclination of the carrying surface of the quenching car. This enables smooth dumping of coke into the wharf without breakage. The coke is dumped in different zones within the wharf. Last in, last out strategy is adopted to enable better control over the moisture in coke. Two plow extractors traverse the length of the wharf and uniformly extract coke and load it onto a conveyor.